Welcome, friends. Welcome back to Cocktails After Dark. Today, we're going to do an old fashioned, a cocktail that is often held up as sort of the pinnacle or one of the cornerstones of cocktail culture. Some people have even put forward the hypothesis that there are only six cocktails and all other cocktails are a derivative of one of those six. And the first among these is the old fashioned. Now, the first instance of a cocktail called the old fashioned that I can find is from 1888, written by Theodore Pruhl. And what's interesting about that old-fashioned cocktail is that it's essentially a take on the cocktail in this book from 1887, written by Jerry Thomas. And his cocktail is called the whisky cocktail. And the story goes that the whisky cocktail had been around for a long time and it started to get stepped on and things were added to it. And in fact, in this cocktail book, a page earlier, there's a new and improved whisky cocktail, which adds a whole bunch of things. And so people would come into the saloon and say, I want a whisky cocktail made in the old-fashioned way, which just got shortened to old-fashioned. And as I go through all of these cocktail books, from the 1800s, 1900s, on into the 1960s, there are dozens of different old-fashioned recipes that you see the recipe expand and contract and expand and contract. And what we have now in this sort of new cocktail culture, the new craft cocktail culture, is a complete return to this recipe from 1887. And in fact, in the latest cocktail book that I bought from Death & Company, their old-fashioned recipe is exactly this old-fashioned recipe from Jerry Thomas. So I find that very interesting that it's expanded and contracted and expanded and contracted. At its core, it is spirit, sugar, bitters, and water. And the water is there mostly in order to dissolve the sugar, but we'll get to that in a moment. So, at its core, this is a whiskey-forward cocktail. All of the other ingredients are there to support and bring forward the flavors in the whiskey. So today I'm going to do it with two different whiskeys. I've got probably 24 different whiskeys over there in the cupboard. I grabbed two at random to kind of give me different flavor profiles. This is an American bourbon, and the one that I'm about to pour here is a Canadian rye whiskey, 100% rye whiskey, and I really like the flavor of this one. So I'm kind of interested to see how these two different spirits from the same family taste different in the end. Now, we'll come to the sugar. In Jerry Thomas's recipe, he calls for gum syrup. In some of these later recipes, they go back to a sugar cube. And the problem with the sugar cube is that you cannot fully dissolve sugar in alcohol, which is where the water comes in. And a lot of the recipes tell you to serve it with a spoon. So when you give it to your customer or your guest, you put a spoon in the glass. And the whole idea with that is, because the sugar cube never dissolves, you want your guest to continually stir it with the ice so that as the ice melts, you get a little bit of water, the sugar dissolves more. So you don't get the sweet at the beginning, you get the sweet at the end after your cocktail is diluted quite a bit. So I'm going to go back to what Jerry did and put in gum syrup. It's two parts sugar, one part water, and gum arabic mixed in. And also the sugar cube brings a bit of theater to the whole thing. You know, you put the sugar cube in and you dash on the bitters and you wait for it to soak in and then you smash it up. I don't need theater. I want great taste in the glass. So I want my sugar to be dissolved. I'm using the gum syrup. Next we come to the bitters. Now, Jerry Thomas asks for Boker's bitters. Boker's bitters aren't available anymore. They stopped making them in 1920. This Boker's bitters that I'm holding in my hand is a reproduction based on the best knowledge of what people have of what's in it. And when you smell it on the nose, you get orange. And it is known for sure that Boker's bitters had bitter orange peel in it. And so when Jerry Thomas is asking for Boker's bitters, that's where that orange component starts to come in. Most later recipes ask for Angostura or Angostura-like bitters. So I'm going to put in two dashes of Angostura into each glass. Then I'm going to put in one orange bitter into each glass to bring in that orange, maybe two. They're small dashes to bring in that orange flavor. And so when you get into later cocktail books, into the 1920s and 1930s, you see old fashions made with Curacao. And that's bringing that bitter orange flavor into it. That's where that orange starts to come in again. And then you get into the 1940s and 1950s, you start to see old fashions with an orange piece put in and muddled in. Or, in the case of a lot of cocktails, a piece of orange peel as a garnish to bring that orange flavor in, because it's missing from the bitters. Now, I've built these cocktails in a mixing glass. In Jerry Thomas's day, he was building it in a shaker and shaking it with ice and then pouring it into a glass. Sort of mid-century, it's a build in the glass over an ice cube type drink. And then we see people going back to doing it in a stirring glass in today's world. I don't really like building in a glass. I find that when you build it in a glass, you can't really stir it well enough. So I'd like this method of making the cocktail. And so I've got two chilled lowball glasses and two giant clear ice cubes. And here we go.
Hey, Glen. Hey, hey, friends.
So, the old fashioned. Wait, I still have to do the garnish. So the garnish is lemon.
And your minimalistic flair?
Yes, very minimalistic flair. I'm not much on flair. It should be in the glass, not left behind the counter. Now, I am going to put an orange peel in as well.
Okay.
Well, tactics vary. A lot of people say you shouldn't squeeze the lemon peel or put the lemon around because it's too fragrant. Other people say the orange and the lemon should be a background player and just put in. There's so many variations on this cocktail. I think what I really want to get across to you is there's so many variations on this cocktail. There is no one way to make it.
Although you can make it every way and just keep trying
and just keep
trying the one you like.
And the variation really comes in the spirit. You want to elevate the spirit that you're using, the whiskey that you're using.
And I have to imagine that has the greatest influence on that.
That is the greatest, yeah. And so as you play with the bitters and the amount of sugar, you're going to find that sweet spot for that whiskey. Right?
I'm just checking to see if he's done talking so we can taste it.
Let's taste it. Okay, so you've got the 1492. That's the 1792. 1492 is a completely different thing.
It's a different year.
1792, that's an American bourbon, and this is Dillon's Rye.
That's pretty good.
Mm-hmm. Interesting. This is tough work.
It is hard. Someone's got to do it.
What do you think?
I think if I was choosing a preference,
yep,
I'd choose this one.
So would I. I would choose the rye. But wait, there's more. Okay.
But that being said,
grab the stir spoon and give it a stir.
There's a square cube in there.
Well, yeah, and there you go. So
I might just give it a little shush because I can't really stir anything.
Building it in a glass can be a bit of a...
Okay, I feel like it's okay. Redistribution.
Okay, so I put in too much.
That changed the mouthfeel completely.
So that's salt.
I was going to say, and it made it taste salty.
Yes.
I was going to add that. Why does it taste salty? Because I thought it was, you know, maybe...
So that's a 2-to-1 salt to water ratio. And I put in too much. I know that I put in too much.
But I actually like how it changed the flavor.
It brings all of the flavors together. And I think that's one of the things that in cocktail making, a lot of people don't talk about. And it certainly doesn't get any play in any of the historical textbooks.
So where did it come from? How did it get into your brain?
In the current cocktail culture, I have met a couple of people who put in a little bit of salt. And that comes from our current understanding of what salt does to enhance flavors. And I think it has a place in the bar. You have to play with it and figure out what that line is between enhancing and becoming something that you actually taste.
Mm-hmm. I'm actually surprised how it changed the texture too, though.
It does change the texture, mm-hmm. Yeah. It makes it...
Creamier,
yeah. And I think that's the word. It doesn't taste like cream, but it makes it that mouth feel of creamier.
Mm-hmm.
Hmm. So there you have the old fashioned, the new old fashioned, the whiskey cocktail. The cornerstone of cocktail making.
That's the best part. It just keeps circling around.
And I'm sure that
you can never get bored.
Well, no. And so I've just taken the old fashioned by adding the salt and shifted it over a little bit to something where someone eventually will come back and go, oh, no, take the salt out.
Does that mean you get to rename it? What should we name our new cocktail?
The old fashioned. Let's stick with the old fashioned. Thanks for stopping by. See you again soon. So I wanted to shoot an addendum to the old-fashioned recipe video because I know that this is going to come up in the comments section, and I thought I'd, you know, touch on it, and then you can have a discussion. This is a cocktail book called The Old Waldorf Bar Days, published in 1931 by people who worked at the bar at the Waldorf Astoria Hotel in New York City. And this book seems to be the genesis of a bit of cocktail mythology. And I'll read it. The Old Fashioned Whiskey, and this is on page 153. This was brought to the Old Waldorf in the days of its sit-down bar and introduced by or in honor of Colonel James E. Pepper of Kentucky, proprietor of a celebrated whiskey of the period. The old-fashioned whiskey cocktail was said to have been the invention of a bartender at the famous Pendennis Club in Louisville, of which Colonel Pepper was a member. This is sort of the first mention, 1931, mention of this story. And a lot of cocktail people, mythology people, have tried to work the dates backwards to make it real. The problem with this story is that James E. Pepper didn't become a member of the Pendennis Club until 1893. By 1893, we already have written, documented proof and history of this cocktail called the Old Fashioned, called the Whiskey Cocktail, called the Old Fashioned Whiskey Cocktail, called the Old Fashioned. It's already out there. It's already published. Long before the Pendennis Club accepts Pepper as a member. And then there are a whole bunch of sort of concurrent stories that try to build on this that list off bartenders who worked at the Pendennis Club who would have created this old-fashioned cocktail or called it the old-fashioned cocktail first. But again, all of those bartenders don't start working at the Pendennis Club until well after both the old-fashioned is already published and Pepper becomes a member. So you're looking at people who started working there as a bartender in 1898 and later. So generally, cocktail historians say that this story is, it's a nice story, but it's not necessarily true. The Old Fashioned already existed, wasn't created at the Pendennis Club, but it looks really good on their website.